Craigie's back and he's got a cracking yarn for us, don't you, Craigie?
Oh, thank you, Sarah. Indeedy, wordy I do. Now, look, for more than four decades, the fabulous Jim Piddock has successfully dazzled in the bright lights of both Broadway and Hollywood. Now, the British-born and wonderfully witty nice guy has no doubt made you laugh and or cry in one of his many varying roles on stage and screen. I had the great pleasure of catching up with Jim recently. We talked his incredible career and I got the inside scoop on some of the juiciest details hot from his brand new memoir, Caught With My Pants Down. That's the memoir, not me. Take a look.
He's a much-in-demand actor, writer and producer. British-born Jim Piddock is a showbiz fave, a star of stage and screen, loved for his truly hilarious turns in movies like Best in Show, A Mighty Wind and For Your Consideration. Well, Jim Piddock, I just have a feeling, I feel it in my waters, this is going to be a rip-roaring chat.
I love that expression, I feel it in my waters.
A little bit of fabulous trivia I unearthed. Is this true that your granddad worked with the great Charlie Chaplin?
Yes, yes. Something I only discovered when I was in my early 20s. I knew very little about my grandparents.
Showbiz can be notoriously fickle, and catching that first big break can be elusive. In Jim's case, before he began acting in earnest, he kept the wolf from the door working an array of unusual day jobs.
One of which was working in a sex shop called Lovejoy's in Paddington in London. It was an interesting experience. I had to learn how to demonstrate the vibrators, which were one speed, two thrust, three speed, three thrust, two speed, and so on. Luckily, I didn't have to demonstrate.
With $100 in his pocket, Jim left the UK in 1981 for the bright lights of Hollywood and Broadway. First stop was San Francisco, where he starred in a play that garnered rave reviews. Then The Great White Way came a-calling.
I went around to every theatre in San Francisco, legitimate and illegitimate, and they all turned me down, of course. I was an unknown British actor with a play about something no one knew anything about at that time. And then right as I was about to go home, back to England, the director of this small theatre called up and said, we've had a show fall through at the last minute. Can you get your show up in 3 to 4 weeks? And so I said, yes, of course I can. The reviews came out after that and it was sensational.
And not only that, you wound up starring on Broadway and being directed by a very reluctant Oscar winner, the great George C. Scott. What was that experience like?
Yeah, the man who described the Oscars as a beauty contest held in a slaughterhouse.
Perhaps it might be better, Mr. President, if you were more concerned with the American people than with your image in the history books.
It was great. I mean, I'd never worked with a big star before. I mean, mostly he was all business. He hated rehearsing, even though he was doing both double duties. And Christine Larty came from a different school of acting, would love to ask, you know, well, what's my intention here? And he'd just go, just get on, say your line and get off, OK? And then we can all go home. And then we'd rehearse for a few hours and then he'd go home and watch the Detroit Tigers or drink himself to oblivion.
It is not in the file. It is not.
There were two sides. There was slightly sober and not at all sober. The more drunk he got, the less clothes he wore.
If it wouldn't be too much trouble, don't want to put anybody out.
You had the joy, I'm presuming, of working with the great Peter Falk, also on stage.
He was a character. He hadn't been on stage for 12 years and it showed. He was lovely. But I was doing a scene with him and he literally was enjoying it so much. He just sort of nodded and smiled to him and says, that was great, that was great. In front of an audience and then continued the play. And then the glass eye would always be like, he'd gone. And he'd know because he'd see your face and then he'd sort of adjust it and he'd continue. And one time he came on stage, everyone was looking at him strangely and he sort of was like, but it wasn't his eye. He'd come on with his flies open, wide open.
Next stop for Jim is Hollywood. And in 1989, he makes his movie debut in Lethal Weapon 2 alongside our Mel Gibson. I hope that Mel Gibson was good to you, Jim.
To be honest with you, I wish I could tell you a Mel Gibson story, but my scene in that film was with Danny Glover and Joe Pesci. And off screen, Gibson was doing some heroic act. And they were distracting me.
Listen to your friend here. He knows what he's talking about.
I played the South African envoy, and it was actually a lovely, quite memorable scene.
I don't think you really want to go to South Africa.
Why not?
And he goes, well, why not? Why can't I do that? And I just look at him completely blankly and go,
because you're black.
And that line, because you're black, became Joe Pesci's sort of favourite go-to line. And so he kept saying it to Danny Glover afterwards in the film. And I still, to this day, have people say to me, but you're black.
You got to play Jackie Weaver's husband, cat of a husband, might I say, in a wonderful movie called The 5-Year Engagement. Now tell me, because I love Jack, you're not going to say anything evil about her, are you?
Oh my God, I adore Jackie.
Isn't she gorgeous?
She's just the best, and we had so much fun. And now you get to hear my bad Australian accent. We both have a pretty rude sense of humour, and she said, oh darling, you could never say anything that could ever shock me. I spent the entire movie trying to say something that would shock her. And I finally did it right near the end, on the second to last day, because she didn't know this, she'd never heard this word before. She just loved it so much that I'd won that bet.
This is why we do not delay weddings.
But Jim is loved for his brilliant work in a string of smash hit Christopher Guest movies, kicking off with Best in Show.
It's very important that all the attributes are examined.
That movie is so funny, but you write in your book that you and Fred Willard, you did all your bits in one day.
We had to. I was writing and producing a TV show in London, and they let me out for 3 days to go shoot Best in Show kindly. So I gave my notes on this sitcom I was doing after the read-through on a Monday morning, got on a plane to Vancouver, arrived Monday night, had dinner with Fred and Eugene Levy, and Chris said at one point, could you just leave the table for about 5 minutes because we want to talk through Fred what he's likely to do, and we don't want you to know, because it's better if you don't.
And I would say maybe in 2 to 3 years this could be a champion dog, but I just think it may be a tad immature for this year.
Just trying to get a little playing time in.
I had to be the ultimate straight man to make him funnier, and I've learned over the years of comedy, the straight man can get as many laughs if you're very clever.
Fred died now coming on to 2 years ago. Was that a shock to you? I mean, as you say, this incredible tornado of energy, always smiling, always upbeat, and now he's no longer with us.
Yeah, it's a real loss. But what was extraordinary about him was that he kept working almost to the very, very end.
Was he a nice man, Jim?
Absolutely delightful. A bit like Barry Humphries, the complete opposite off camera. He was the furthest thing from that boorish extrovert.
My mother was the cold north wind. My daddy was the sun.
You got to team up again with the great Christopher Guest and, of course, Fred and all the gang in a wonderful movie called A Mighty Wind, which is about the reunion of a folk band. Your memories of that must be fond. What a great cast.
Yeah, it was lovely. I played Catherine O'Hara's husband and Eugene Levy played her ex-husband. It was a great dynamic. And what was fun for me was I flipped. I was the person that had to say outrageous things.
I'm a model train enthusiast.
Thank God for model trains.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, if they didn't have the model train, they wouldn't have gotten the idea for the big trains.
But before he became the toast of Tinseltown with his brilliant comedy chops, Jim wrote a movie in 2004 called A Different Loyalty.
You know I intend to marry her.
Based around British traitor and double agent Kim Philby. The movie starred Sharon Stone. And working with Sharon was an experience Jim won't ever forget.
I had a scene with her and she went, oh, hello, I'm Sharon. She introduced herself and proceeded to pretend that she didn't know me. Now, maybe she didn't. Maybe she had forgotten that I'd written this fantastic role for her that she'd just spent 2 hours with me 2 days before talking about. But either way, she wanted nothing to do with me.
You are hereby ordered to serve time as a tooth fairy.
On the flip side, Jim wrote a wonderful comedy called Tooth Fairy with Dwayne Johnson, Billy Crystal and Dame Julie Andrews, stars he adored working with.
Dwayne Johnson, who I had not met, he stopped the filming, called everyone together, the whole cast and crew, and made a lovely speech and said, you are only here because of this man, and introduced me. And I just was blown away because I've never seen a writer treated like that on a set, ever.
So, Jim,
to your rip-roaring memoir, Caught With My Pants Down, it is getting absolute raves. Everybody from Hugh Bonneville to the fabulous Jean Smart, Russell Brand, Jackie Weaver, they are all saying it is the most dishy, fabulous, wonderful book that they've read. So my question is, did you feel as though, oh, maybe I've told a little too much? You know, when they talk about spilling the tea, I mean, I think in your case it's more a tsunami. Did you ever have any druthers thinking, my gosh, I think I may have gone just that bit too far?
The only time I got a bit nervous was about 3 weeks ago. I suddenly woke up one morning going, oh my God, I hope there isn't anything that is actually slanderous in there. It's all true, but whether it could be read as such, and it's all true, so I don't care. They can do what they like. They've got to prove me wrong, and good luck.
It's doubtful that you'll receive a Chrissy card from Sharon Stone, among others.
Dear Jim, love, Shaz.